Welcome to the Cataraqui Woods Dental Implant Institute, a nonprofit organization with the mission and vision of furthering both education and research in the field of oral implantology. My name is Dr. Waji Khan. I'm a dental surgeon and also the course director for an online series of lectures provided as a service to the profession of dentistry to deliver a literature and knowledge-based approach to dental implant education for practitioners interested in learning more about how to implement the discipline of oral implantology into their clinical practice. This online course should be merged with a suitable clinical course and long-term mentorship study club program so that the learner can maximize their benefit from the didactic online program. The production of this series of lectures was partially funded by an educational grant from the International Dental Implant Academy. Lecture 6, The Big Enchilada, The Surgical Phase. So we've basically been going through a number of lectures to get to this point where we talk about the surgical placement of dental implants. However, you will have noticed a number of checklists that we have provided in the preceding lectures, and we're going to provide a checklist in this lecture as well, a pre-surgical checklist. Now, checklists have been adopted by the Air Force in order to mitigate or to eliminate or reduce the incidences of adverse outcomes. These have also been adopted in many operating rooms across North America and have been demonstrated to show reduction of surgical error. So in terms of pre-surgical checklist, number one, we want to ensure that the consent forms have been reviewed and confirmed with the patient. You want to ensure that the patient is aware that they're getting dental implant treatment done and they're not getting a left hip replacement. Number two, you want to ensure that sedation and anesthetic techniques have been confirmed. Many times I've had patients come in to see me and they say to me, oh, so I'm going to be totally out, right? Well, we usually will cover this more in their consent process. However, the worst thing is to perhaps have a patient coming in with a misunderstanding with respect to the type of sedation or anesthetic technique that's going to be performed for them. If you're going to be doing anesthesia, you also want to ensure that the NPO status has been confirmed. There's no point in operating on a patient where some sort of aspiration is going to become an issue. Number four, if a patient is being sedated, you want to ensure that some type of responsible adult or escort has been confirmed and that they are present in the facility and will be available should you require them. Number five, you want to ensure that if any preoperative medications are required for the patient as per the American Heart Association guidelines, or this patient has had some sort of a prosthetic joint replacement, that appropriate preoperative medications have been provided for them. Number six, you want to ensure that the surgical technique and sites have been confirmed for the patient and along with the surgical team as well. Number seven, you want to ensure that the surgical drill system and corresponding dental implants are available. Going to number eight, ensuring that a backup surgical handpiece and drill system are available should your primary system malfunction. It's also advisable to have a variety of implant sizes and extra implants and extra components available. As we mentioned in previous lectures, surprises in implant dentistry are never a good thing. And intraoperatively, should a implant, say, not fit, a component fall onto the floor, a graft material become contaminated, the worst thing to do is to not be able to carry forward with the procedure or even have to, perhaps call a colleague down the street to borrow these components in order to facilitate treatment. Number nine, ensuring that ancillary grafting tissues are available. And number 10, if it's the case that a surgical guide is going to be used, that the guide is present, and if it's the case that you're operating using a semi-sterile or sterile setup, that the surgical guide has been sterilized. Number 11, ensuring that appropriate radiographs and images are present and displayed. So if it's the case that you're using film-based radiographs, ensuring that there's an appropriate view box within close proximity to the operating site so that should the surgeon need to refer back to these images, that ability is readily available. And also, if it's the case that digital radiographs are being used, that there's some form of display within the operating room theater so that the surgeon can refer to those radiographs in order to confirm either previous films or if intraoperative films are going to be used, a means by which to display these intraoperative films within close proximity to the operating room theater. And lastly, if it's the case that a transitional prosthesis is going to be used postoperatively or intraoperatively in order to determine if adequate reduction of bones, assuming we're doing something like an all-on-4 procedure, or even to ensure that the implants or the implant sites that are going to be selected are going to be taking maximum advantage of where this prosthesis is supposed to be, that this prosthesis is present, that the surgical guides, as mentioned previously in point 10, are present, and that they've been sterilized. So contraindications to implant treatment, things that we want to ensure that are not present, or things that are going to basically not allow us to proceed with implant therapy for a patient. So I realize this sort of gets to the point where we should have covered a lot of this stuff previously. However, as mentioned in previous lectures and in future lectures, when we talk about complications or management of complications in implant dentistry, assuming that somebody else has done something or has ruled something out is always a bad thing. So prior to operating, if you are the surgical dentist, it is your responsibility to ensure that these things are not present in patients. So radiotherapy to the jawbone in order to mitigate problems like osteoradionecrosis of the jaw. Patients who have untreated intraoral pathology or malignancy. Sometimes patients go from the treatment planning to the surgical stage over a period of months, either that being they need to get their finances in order or it was just a bad timing. I had one patient one time who basically came in for a consult in January. We weren't doing the procedure until July. And unfortunately, between that period of time, had been diagnosed with breast cancer. Number three, untreated periodontal disease. As we're going to cover in the lectures on peri-implant diseases, a lot of the pathogens that are involved in the development of periodontal disease are the same pathogens that are involved in the development of peri-implant mucositis and peri-implantitis. As such, untreated periodontal disease should be viewed as a contraindication to the placement of implant therapy. Number four, uncontrolled drug or alcohol use, as these can lead to impairments not only in bone healing, but also issues with relation to hemostasis of the patient intraoperatively. Number five, uncontrolled psychiatric disorders. Number six, a recent MI or heart surgery. Number seven, intravenous bisphosphonate therapy. Number eight, some form of immunosuppression. Number nine, poor oral hygiene. And lastly, age. Any patient who's under the age of 18, you're relying upon some form of facial skeleton growth still taking place, usually up till about age 25 is what the studies by Dr. Woodside at the Burlington Growth Center have reported to us. However, an implant, when it's placed inside the patient below this age, we sort of view implants when they integrate into the bone as sort of ankylosis of that implant inside the jaw. And so as the alveolar processes mature, unlike natural teeth that will rise in height, an implant tooth viewing it as an ankylose tooth will be submerged in that occlusal plane. And as such, placement of an implant in a patient under the age of 18 should be viewed as a contraindication. So now we're going to go into surgical operatory setup. So in this photograph, I've basically demonstrated a picture I downloaded from the internet of what is typically seen inside an operating room in the majority of hospitals around the world. And as you can see, that there's a large amount of room here for pretty much everybody. So the surgeon, the assistants, the anesthetists, the ancillary staff who are going to be assisting with either movement of certain pieces of equipment or accessing radiographs and all types of other things. Unfortunately, this is not how the routine dental practice looks. These operating rooms are also very accustomed or structured. Recall we talked about strategy and structure needing to be two things that work together. Unfortunately, the structure of these rooms also supports the strategy of having an aseptic protocol and forming invasive surgeries. Unfortunately, we take a look at the next photograph. This is my dental operatory prior to opening my practice a few years back. And as you can see, in terms of size of this room, despite the fact that when I structured the manufacturing of these rooms, I made sure that there was going to be adequate counter space for things like implant drills and bone grafting kits and for and for centrifuges and all types of other cool pieces of technology that we use. However, this is not how my operatory looks today. In this photograph, you can see, well, this is what my operatory to provide routine dental care looks like today. And this looks nothing like the operating room that I demonstrated or I showed you in the first picture. And unfortunately, this is the type of room within which we're going to be trying to provide dental implant treatment. Here's another operatory in my practice, once again demonstrating what a typical dental office looks like. So we know that from studies on the incidence of infection, sterile setups, or at least reducing the bacterial load that's going to be in the surgical site is going to reduce the incidences of infection or postoperative infection inside our patient. So sterile techniques improve upon surgical outcomes and prevent post-surgical infections. However, the one thing we need to consider when doing implant therapy is that we are working in a dirty field in which prevention of contamination can be difficult. The biggest villain inside the mouth is actually the tongue. The tongue, if one is to take a culture from it, you'll find everything. And despite the use of preoperative chlorhexidine rinses and preoperative scrubbing techniques, it's almost impossible to get a sterile environment within the mouth. So in terms of aseptic protocol, we talk about different types of surgeries. We talk about clean surgery, so something like a splenectomy. We talk about clean contaminated surgery, which is where we're going to be working most of the time, and this is things like oral surgery. Then you're going to talk about things like contaminated surgery, and an example of this would be something like rectal surgery. And then finally, we talk about things like dirty surgery, and this is usually penetrating trauma, so like a gunshot wound or gunshot wound to the face or gunshot wound to the abdomen. So the goal of aseptic technique is to protect the patient by preventing or minimizing postoperative infections by creating conditions and following procedures to prevent the introduction of microbial contamination to sterile fields, sterile equipment, and the operative site. So general considerations. So we're going to talk about aseptic procedures here. Only sterile items are used within the sterile field. So prior to items being dispensed to the sterile field, check the external and internal chemical indicators on and in the package. Check for package integrity. Make sure these packages have not been soiled. And also check for package expiration if appropriate. Number two, items which display a manufacturer's expiry date shall be considered unsafe for use after that date. And the rationale here is expiry dates do not guarantee either sterility or lack of sterility. Frequently expired dates refer to degradation of the products or a component of the product after the specified date. Number three, if in doubt about the sterility of a packaged item, this is not considered sterile. So this includes items found in unmonitored areas. B, indication of the package being wet, so wet stains, dampness, or condensation inside the package. C, any package without a chemical indicator showing a pass result. And in terms of chemical indicator, I'm talking about class 5 chemical indicator strips. D, any package that has been dropped. And E, any package that shows evidence of crushing, perforations, or holes. Number four, whenever a sterile item has been compromised, the package contents, gown, or the sterile field involved must be considered contaminated. And this may happen when non-sterile items contact sterile items and liquids or moisture seep through a drape, gown, or package. Number five, single-use medical devices shall only be used on an individual client for a single procedure and then must be discarded. Reusable medical devices shall be reprocessed according to the manufacturer's directions for use. So we're now going to talk about establishment of the sterile field. Number one, sterile drapes used to cover surfaces or operative fields shall provide a barrier against microorganisms, liquids, and particulate matter. Two, drapes are only sterile at the table level. That means A, the drape below the working surface is not under direct vision of the surgical team and is thus not considered sterile. The edges of the tabletop serve as a demarcation line between sterile and non-sterile. B, any item that falls below the table level is considered unsterile. This applies to the edges of the drape and portion of suction and irrigation tubing that is handed off the sterile field. Number three, if the drape does not cover the entire surface, a 1-inch margin around the edge of the drape is not considered sterile. Number four, the edges of packages are not considered sterile. When opening packages for a sterile procedure, The packaging must be managed in a manner which prevents the wrapper from touching the sterile field or package contents. All flaps of non-woven wrap must be controlled to prevent them from touching the sterile field. The sterile boundary of a peel-open package is the inner edge. Peel pouches should be peeled back, not ripped or torn when opening. Devices should not be pushed through the peel pouch. The inner edge of the seal is the demarcation for sterile and non-sterile. Items should not be flipped or dropped onto the sterile field. Number 5, all flat surfaces shall be dry and dust-free before placing a sterile bundle or drape on them. And the rationale here is moisture may carry strike through, soaking through, and contaminate the sterile field. Dust may become airborne and land on the sterile field. So when dispensing sterile supplies, number 1, supplies shall be opened as close as possible to the surgical start time. Then the rationale here is the potential for contamination increases with time, and particles stirred up by a movement of personnel can settle on horizontal surfaces, things like dust. Number 2, sterile supplies shall be handled as little as possible. And the rationale here is increased handling increases the potential for contamination and prolonged setup time. Number 3, all items added to sterile field shall be addressed prior to opening for sterility by checking package integrity and that chemical indicators show a pass result. Number 4, large bundles or packages shall be opened on a flat surface. And the rationale here is large and or heavy items are difficult to open aseptically while being held in the circulating assistant's hand. Number 5, items introduced onto a sterile field should be opened, dispensed, and transferred by methods that maintain sterility and integrity. Number 6, methods of transfer include, but are not limited to the following. Place the item on the edge of the sterile instrument table with the inside of the wrapper covering your hand. Never reach over a sterile field and shake an item from its package. Expose the contents so the scrubbed assistant can remove the item from the wrapper or package using a forceps or by grasping the item. Items shall not be flipped onto the sterile field. And the rationale here is flipping creates air turbulence and it also creates the potential for contamination or damage. Continuing along with this, number 7, sterile solution must be poured into a sterile receptacle. The scrubbed assistant holds the receptacle away from the table or places it on the edge of the draped surface, eliminating the need for the circulating assistant to reach across the sterile field. Number 8. Once the contents, the sterile solution of the bottle, have been dispensed into the sterile receptacle, discard any remaining solution. And the rationale here is reapplication of caps is a questionable technique as the pour spout and cap may have been contaminated. The edge of a container is considered contaminated after the contents have been poured. Therefore, the sterility of the contents cannot be ensured if the cap is replaced. Number 9. Once a patient has entered the operatory where sterile supplies have been opened, those supplies shall be discarded and dismantled in the event the procedure is canceled or if they are not used. And the rationale here is there's potential for cross-contamination, which can be prevented. In terms of maintaining the sterile field, Number one, the circulating assistant shall not touch or reach over sterile items or areas. And the rationale here is there's invisible shedding of skin laden with microorganisms, which may contaminate sterile items or areas. Number 2, the scrubbed assistant shall not touch or reach over unsterile items or areas. And the rationale here is there could be contamination of a sterile gown or gloves, which may occur. Number 3, when a scrubbed assistant opens a sterile table cover or drape, it is open first towards the sterile individual. This minimizes the chance of the scrubbed assistant becoming contaminated by contacting a non-sterile surface. Number 4. If the circulating assistant opens a sterile pack, the wrap is open first away from the circulating assistant to prevent contamination of the pack. Number 5. Movement within the sterile field must not contaminate the field. Sterile personnel stay close to the sterile field. If sterile personnel must change positions during the procedure, they can move face-to-face or back-to-back. They must never turn their back on the sterile field. Number 6. Open sterile supplies or setup shall not be left unattended and shall be continuously monitored for possible contamination. And the rationale here is sterility of unattended items cannot be ensured without direct observation. Event-related sources of possible contamination can occur at any time. Number 7. The sterile setup shall not be covered, and the rationale here is removing a table cover without contaminating the sterile area cannot be achieved. the drape below the level of the tabletop is considered contaminated, and the cover would touch the tabletop during removal. So surgical hand asepsis is basically the process of removing as many microorganisms as possible from the hands and forearms by mechanical washing and chemical antisepsis before participating in a surgical procedure. This should be performed prior to donning sterile gloves or sterile gowns and gloves for surgical and other invasive procedures. And this can be achieved with either an antimicrobial surgical scrub agent, like a surgical hand scrub, or an alcohol-based antiseptic surgical hand rub, the surgical hand rub, with documented persistent and cumulative activity. If hands are visibly soiled, they must be washed and dried prior to performing surgical hand antisepsis. All rings, watches, and bracelets must be removed prior to starting surgical hand antisepsis. Hair covers, protective eyewear, and surgical mask must be donned prior to initiating the surgical hand antisepsis. The objective of surgical hand antisepsis is to reduce the transient and resident flora. Skin can never be rendered sterile. It can be made surgically clean by reducing the number of organisms present with the mechanical action associated with scrubbing. Surgical hand antisepsis is only effective if all surfaces of the hand are exposed to the mechanical cleaning and chemical antisepsis. Water flows down, so hands should be held above the level of the elbow, both during the scrub and rinsing if a surgical hand scrub is used. Contact with the faucet or other potential contaminants must be avoided. Thorough drying is essential, as most surfaces allow pathogens to multiply. A sterile towel must be used to dry hands following a surgical hand scrub. If a surgical hand rub product is used, the manufacturer's instructions for its use must be followed and the product must have a persistent effect and be fast drying. We have a few videos for you to watch now.
I'm covering my hands with a cream that glows under ultraviolet light. This represents the bacteria that is normally on your hands. If I then quickly wash my hands, and replace them back under the ultraviolet light, you can see where the cream remains in the creases of the skin and around the fingernails. By pressing fingertips on the agar plate, some of the bacteria on the hand are transferred onto the jelly. The agar plate is incubated overnight, and this is the result the next morning. Each little white dot is the result of one bacterial cell from the hand multiplying millions of times overnight. Your clothing, jewellery and watches carry bacteria, so they mustn't come into contact with patients. Before you clean your hands, roll up your sleeves, tuck in your tie if you have one, take off your wristwatch and any rings with stones or ridges on them. Only smooth wedding rings like this one are acceptable, but you still need to clean under and around them. To squirt some alcohol hand rub into the palm of one hand, rub the fingertips and the fingernails into it, spread it into the palm of the other hand and do the same with the fingertips and the fingernails. Make sure that all surfaces of the hands are covered, the outside of the thumbs, and keep rubbing until the alcohol hand rub has dried. The amount of rub that you use depends on the size of your hands and the brand of alcohol. Put the rub into the palm of one hand. As you spread it across the palm with your fingertips, you're starting to decontaminate both the palm and your fingertips. Pass some onto the other palm and spread it with the other fingertips. Now work on the back of both hands and in between your fingers. If you are wearing a wedding ring, make sure that you clean around and under the ring. The idea is to cover all the surfaces of both hands up to the wrists and keep rubbing until the alcohol dries. Wet your hands using warm but not hot water. Use about a teaspoon of soap, covering the palms, working in between the fingers. Again, on the backs of the hands, in between the fingers. Interlock the fingers so that the fingernails are cleaned. Cover the outside of the thumbs and up to the wrists. This should take about 15 seconds or 2 to 3 verses of Happy Birthday to You. Rinse well and dry the hands thoroughly. Turn off the taps either using the paper towel or your elbow. Avoid a common mistake. Make sure that you open the bin with your foot, not with your hands. It's important to wet your hands with comfortably warm water before you put the soap on. This stops the soap drying out your hands. Use about 1 teaspoon worth of soap. Rub the palms together to make sure they're completely covered with soap up to the wrists. Then rub between the fingers. Now use your palms on the backs of the hands and again between the fingers. Next, to clean the fingertips and nails, interlock the fingers and ripple them like this and rotate them against each other. Finally, rub around the outside of each thumb. The whole process should take about 15 seconds. Rinse off all the soap with water and dry your hands carefully with a paper towel. Dry the palms and backs of your hands to help remove any remaining bacteria. Work the towel between the fingers and underneath and around your nails. Use the towel or your elbow to turn off the tap. Open the pedal bin with your foot to dispose of the towel.
So that was a very informative video on hand washing technique. One of the things that I, in my undergraduate medical training, found as truly amazing was that despite the fact that one scrubs one's hands, there was an experiment that they had us do in the microbiology lab in which we surgically scrubbed our hands and then using these scrubbed hands touched one of the microbiology plates. They then had us use just non-sterile exam gloves, put those on and touch another microbiology plate, and then finally take sterile gloves, put those on and touch a third microbiology plate. These plates were then incubated and brought back to show the cultures which grew upon them. And what was absolutely truly amazing was, despite the efforts that had been made in surgically scrubbing one's hands, it was quite evident that from what was growing on top of these microbiology plates, that it was almost impossible to get one's hands sterile. It was possible to get them clean. It was almost impossible to get them sterile. Just something which is important for you to note. So in terms of hand hygiene tips, we note 5 things here. Number 1, that nails must be natural, clean, short, and appear healthy. Number 2, nail polish, if worn, it must be fresh for 4 days or less and never chipped. Number 3, do not wear artificial nails or nail enhancements. Number 4, remove all hand and arm jewelry for invasive surgical procedures. This includes wedding rings. If one's concerned about losing their wedding ring, what I've seen many surgeons do is actually have a necklace on and just tie these on so that you're not keeping them, if you're assuming you're operating in a group practice or in an operating room or a rented operating room. This is at least ensures that you're not going to lose this in a locker. Number 5, if you have cuts or abrasions or weeping dermatitis or fresh tattoos on exposed skin, you should not scrub. We now have another video for you.
For every first scrub of the day, you should use a brush and clean nails thoroughly. Open with dry hands. Hold the brush in one hand and use the nail pick to clean your nails under running water. Once cleaned, dispose of the pick. The brush should only ever be used on your nails. Wet the brush and your arms. Add soap to your brush and brush nails for 15 seconds. Under running water, brush your nails for another 5 seconds. Repeat for other hand. Once complete, dispose of brush and continue with the scrub procedure. Re-wet your hands and arms thoroughly and apply soap and lather for 60 seconds. Keeping your hands elevated, rinse for 10 to 15 seconds. Reapply soap and lather hands and arms for a further 90 seconds. Continue hand washing by rinsing your hands only. This ensures that the soap left on your arms continues to kill germs and absorb onto your skin as a barrier. Paying special attention to space between and behind fingers and thumbs, reapply soap to hands and wash for 60 seconds. Keeping your hands higher than your elbows, rinse hands and arms well. Rub palms under running water to remove soap traces. This method should take 3 to 4 minutes, depending on whether it is the first or consecutive scrub of the day.
So, we're now going to talk about this sterilium dry scrub. The beauty of the sterilium rub is you have rapid, long-lasting antiseptics that are gentle on your skin. Basically, you have high concentrations of alcohol. Sterilium rub has 80% and sterilium rub fragrance-free, which is 85%, which ensures a rapid but also extensive and thorough effect in terms of sterilizing or cleaning one's hands. This meets the United States FDA's TFM and international efficacy specifications for surgical asepsis. Non-drying and formulated with emollients that leaves hands feeling soft and smooth, and this also saves time and leaves the hands less sticky for a quicker rub to glove. We will now watch the video.
Sterilium Rub is a brushless, waterless, alcohol-based surgical hand rub. The FDA classifies Sterilium Rub as an over-the-counter drug, and due to its use of ethyl alcohol as its single active ingredient, it is FDA compliant. Sterilium Rub is formulated with 80% ethanol and a well-balanced proprietary blend of emollients that leave hands feeling soft and smooth, not greasy or sticky. As a result, it rubs in thoroughly and rapidly, which leads to quicker, easier glove donning. It is often preferred by healthcare personnel since it minimizes the undesirable residual buildup that is often associated with other lotion-based and gel-style surgical products. Sterilium Rub delivers exceptional immediate and 6-hour persistent efficacy against a broad range of pathogens and meets both the relevant FDA standards for surgical hand rub and the European surgical efficacy specifications. The Sterilium Rub dispenser is user-friendly, safe, and reliable. Our most advanced dispenser option is the hands-free or touchless version. This dispenser can be customized by the user on site to deliver 1, 2, or 3 doses of Sterilium Rub per activation. Using a touchless dispenser eliminates unsightly cables and foot pumps that are frequently positioned beneath scrub sinks, and sometimes frustrate staff who may find it difficult to determine which foot pump goes with which hand hygiene product. The touchless dispenser also eliminates the issue of clogged foot pumps typically associated with lotion products. However, when the foot pump dispensing option is desired, the design of the cable system of the Sterilium Rub foot dispenser, combined with the consistency of the product, eliminates any concern and inconvenience caused by clogging. The foot pump dispenser also has reinforced tubing around the cable, where it connects to the pedal, to ensure additional strength and durability. Both touchless and foot pump models deliver a consistent measured dose with each activation.
So following the completion of the surgical hand antisepsis, whether that be with a wet or dry scrub, it is important to correctly don a sterile surgical gown and sterile gloves. Gowns are only considered sterile in the front from the axilla, the armpit, to the level of the sterile field, and sleeves from 5 centimeters, 2 inches above the elbow to cuff. The neck, shoulders, underarms, sleeve cuffs, and the back are considered unsterile. Let's watch a video.
Okay, everybody, we finished scrubbing. I wanted to tell you, a lot of people say to me, can I touch my fingers after I scrub? It's not really necessary. Just if you want to keep your hands up, the most important thing you need to remember is once you scrub, don't do this. Don't put your hands below your waist. Your hands have to stay up above your waist at this point from now on, okay? And just bend a little bit at the waist. Just keep your hands up. And remember, when you go into the room, the door will be closed, so you're going to have to open it going backwards in with hands in front. Remember, don't go through this process and push the door open. Whee! That's not what we do. We go in with our backs. Okay, so I've done my scrub. My hands are above my waist. And Robin, the surgical tech is going to come. Actually, she's a nurse. And nurses and techs do scrub. And she's going to hand me the towel. Usually, like I said, this is for everybody that's left-handed, this is a right man's world. So she's going to put this glove on this blue towel on my right hand. Excuse me, on my left hand, and I'm going to dry my right hand first. How do I do that? I twist each finger in the towel, and I twist my arm up, okay? I pay attention to bend forward, because if I'm doing this, I've already contaminated this towel, and they have to give me a new one. So remember, at this point, you are bent forward, twist your fingers, twist up, all the way up. Now, I have to dry my left hand. Oh my God, how am I gonna do that? Ladies and gentlemen, it's very easy. You see this towel? I have, this hand has to be dried. I have this, just take this towel, if this makes sense. You wanna think of this towel as a half and a half. So I just put my dry hand under the dry side, and I take my wet hand and dry the next hand. Okay, and repeat the same process as I did. So remember everybody, it's one hand, put the other hand, the dry hand underneath, wet on top. Okay, one more time. Hand, wipe. Put my dry hand under the dry side, wipe. When I'm finished, I'm going to put that in the correct receptacle. Okay? So I hope that makes sense to everybody. That's where everybody gets a little nervous about the towel, but if you just think of it like a platter, or just an open cloth, one, two. There's no necessary, and I'm going to show you one thing. I'm taking this back, excuse me. There's no reason to be twisting and turning this back and forth and flipping. That's not necessary. Because remember, this has lint on it. You don't want to be throwing lint around the OA. Okay? So that's taken care of, and now it's time to gown. Okay? Okay, everyone. So now my faithful assistant, Robin, who's another registered nurse, she's been going to help us to demonstrate the next part, is putting the gown and the gloves on. Okay? So just pretend like we normally do in the class that I am the scrub tech, and I've come to you with the gown and glove. Okay? The first thing they're going to do is come, and she's going to hold this up to you. See how Robin's arms are right here? They're not up in the air. They're not down here. They're almost like shoulder level. The minute she does that, the scrub nurse is going to bend her arm, your arm, like so, and she's going to pull this down, your cuff down, to about halfway. The reason we do that is when we put your gloves on, we don't want your gown all the way up here. So we give it a little space, okay? So we're going to pull right down to here. Remember that when they're putting the gown on, after the gown is on, bend your arms like so. Now, I'm pretend now, because this is all simulation, now I'm the circulator. I've gone from the scrub tech to the circulator. The circulator or one of your contemporaries can come behind and tie you up, okay? All right? So that's done. Now, okay. Now the next thing we're going to do is we're going to put the gloves on. If you're left-handed like myself, this is a right man's world, like I've told you. Everything is done with the right hand first. So what's going to happen? The scrub tech is going to open the glove up, and she's going to hold it open like so, and you're going to put your hand in. Very good. Now say she makes a mistake like she did. That's okay. Once you start the process, don't try to pull your hand up because you made a mistake. You continue with the process because when you put your second glove on, you can fix it. What happens with the left glove is this is where you have audience participation, so to speak. You're going to help put on your second glove. You're going to also hold it like this, but you're going to put your fingers out, hand out, and you're going to put the second glove on. Now you're able to fix your gloves. Okay? Robin is almost ready now to go. Okay, now it's time to take the tie. A lot of people get very nervous with the tie because they don't know which end is which. The only thing that, I try to think of a little clue. The only thing I can say is the longest tie which you see is to your right is the one that the tag goes on, okay? The short one is to the left. So what you're gonna do with your left hand, you're gonna take the left string. With your right hand, you're gonna grab the tag with the string. Now, as me, if I was a circulator, my dual role, I can only touch this, if the tech is not here, I can only touch this part. Now, if I was the scrub tech, I can take this right from Robin, any part of it. So just remember, there's a green line there, only half. If you're not scrubbed, you can only touch the green half. She's going to let go, and she's going to twirl. Okay, she's going to take that one off, and she's going to tie it. Don't tie it too tight, where you can't get it off. Where it's so tight. Now, the reason I tell you that is when it's time for taking the gown off. Okay. Now Robin is finished. She'll follow along with me. Now that we're done, we can put our hands like so. We can fold them. We can put our hands like this. We can even put our hands right up to our elbows. Okay? If we want, we can hold on to our gown. What we cannot do is we cannot put our hands below our waist. I don't want to see anybody with their hands underneath their armpits because it's not sterile down there. And I don't want to see anybody with their hands on their hips. Okay? We're not that smart. Okay, so again, hands folded, hands touching the shanks of your arms, or holding your gown. That's a proper way to be in a gown. The next thing we're going to go in the front, there's only two more things I need to show you now, is how do we operate, or how do we move around in the operating room once we're gowned and gloved. Pretend, if you will, that this is the table where the patient is. What can you do? You can put your hands lightly on the OR table where the patient is. Nobody puts elbows in the patient. I know sometimes they ask you to hold retractors. That doesn't give you the go-ahead to get your elbows in here and put your elbows into the patient. Remember, this is a patient. I know some of them are nice and soft, but do not do that, please. You really can hurt them. Okay? So, we're standing here together. If you're standing for a long period of time and you get tired, on all the OR tables there's a little lever. There's a little level, like the bottom of it. You can always put your foot up on that, and that helps to release some of the pressure from your back. Now, we were here with Dr. Slakey during our liver resection. He said, Nancy, I need you and Robin to switch places because I need you up here. How do we do that? Always remember sterile to sterile and non-sterile to non-sterile. So if I'm moving towards Robin, what is she going to do? She's going to turn. And she's going to come around, and she's going to be right here. Okay, let's do that one more time. Now with her moving towards me, we turn back to back and front to front. And somebody asked me, well, how do I know if I'm being the back to back or the front to front? I always say whoever makes the first move, that's going to be the person going sliding. Okay, the person that doesn't, that is waiting, is going to be the person that's turning. Now, how do we move about the table? How will we get around the OR table? What Robin will do, if they need her to get on the other side of the room, other side of the table, she will keep her sterile self facing the table and she'll move around this way. Always keeping, always towards sterile. Okay, now you'll say, well, sometimes in the operating room, Nancy, you know, I've got to walk all the way around like the Bovie and some other things. Well, you do have to do that sometimes, but you still always want to face forward. Other people say, well, you know, the table's back there with all the instruments on it and my back isn't sterile. It's okay because your back is not directly onto the table like this. You are moving in this kind of an action. Okay, so you're always keeping that sterile movement. Okay, any questions? I don't think so. Okay, now the last thing we're going to do is, if Robin will come over here, we're going to say, how do we ungown? ways now of taking your gown off. After you've popped, some people like to keep their gloves on, some people take them off. If you're not taking your gloves off, if you're leaving your gloves off, which I normally do in case I have to do anything else, I pull the gown down and roll forward, always away from you. And then, so the gown, so once the gown is off, that goes in the red receptacle, remember that. And how do we take gloves off? Remember, skin to skin and glove to glove. So to take a glove off, you want to take glove, and then you stick your finger underneath and take glove. There you go. Okay? That way, nothing that's on these gloves is touching you. Okay? If you choose, some places do require, prefer that you take your gloves off with your gown, that means to pull the whole thing off. Okay? And if you have to touch anything else, put a pair of utility gloves on. Okay? That's it for this part of operating well in the operating room.
So drapes and draping. We're now going to go over a video for proper drape and draping when working in the head and neck area. One is probably wondering, okay, hold on a second here. We do all of these oral surgical procedures without all of this surgical hand wash and aseptic technique and drapes and draping. Why all of a sudden for implant dentistry are we recommending drapes and draping and all these things? Well, we have to sort of go back to where implant dentistry started. Remember that Dr. Per Ingvard Brandemark was an orthopedic surgeon, and the majority of times when orthopedic surgeons are operating, they do so in an operating room in an aseptic environment. In the dental office, as we've covered in this lecture, when one is to look at the strategy and the structure of implant surgery, and one is to look at the structure of the majority of dental practices out there, going to an aseptic technique and using things like drapes and draping and aseptic technique is not necessarily something which is going to be easy to do or comfortable or even cost effective to achieve, whether that's even achievable at all. I'm going to go back to my own career. I was observing a colleague of mine extract a tooth on a patient in a foreign country. And more or less, we were standing there wearing just normal clothing and wearing regular non-sterile exam gloves, and the tooth broke. And he said to me, he looked at me and said, okay, now we have to go surgical here. And basically backed out of the area. Now, nothing changed in terms of the structure of the area. Everyone remained where they were. All the instruments remained exactly where they were. And this surgeon went into another room, performed a surgical scrub, got a sterile gown placed on, put on a sterile gloves, and returned back to the same patient. No other changes or preparations has been made, and he asked for an instrument, and his assistant with a bare hand passed him the instrument, and he continued along. Now, I sort of chuckled. I sort of said to myself, what was the purpose of the whole dog and pony show over there? But what we're trying to basically achieve in this lecture is to ensure that people who are taking this course are aware of some of these other things that are out there and some of the suggested best practices that one should be trying to employ when one is approaching the implementation of implantology into their dental practice. If we were going to be doing a more invasive procedure on a patient, it would perhaps behoove us to take some of these concepts and try to implement them into our daily practice. So this next video is going to cover draping and drapes for you.
Draping instruction for the barrier headset from Mölnlycke Healthcare. Prior to draping, please note the pictogram and keep the drape in the right direction. And fold until you see three pictograms. One pictogram shows the direction of the drape and the other two shows where to put your hands. Put your hands in the corners and unfold the drape. Put the drape under the head and partly under the shoulders of the patient. Take the corner of the drape and unfold over the patient. Pull the drape towards the patient's feet. Do the same on the other side. Cross the drape over the patient. Take one corner of the drape and drape around the part of the face or neck that the procedure involves. Hold the drape tightly to the head and fold over the other side of the drape. Use the adhesive tape to fix the turban in place. Remove the release paper. Position the adhesive OP sheet centered over the body and unfold the drape. And finally unfold fully towards the feet. Draping is then completed. To find out more about how the barrier headset makes draping more efficient and secure, download the product sheet from www.mernlicher.com.
So we finally get to the point now where we need to start talking about some of the surgical armamentaria of dental implants. So the first thing to cover is the surgical motor and hand pieces. And basically, the workhorse of the implant industry is this unit called the Implant Med, made by a company called W&EH. It has been around for a long time, and it's been customized for various companies to sort of give everyone sort of their own balkanistic opportunity to provide implant surgeons with a surgical unit that bears their branding. It also has built-in irrigation and an easy-to-use foot pedal, along with the option of purchasing a travel box if one is an implant dentist that's traveling from multiple offices. So this in this photograph, you can see a picture of just the standard W&H implant med unit. In the next photograph, you'll see a picture on the left is 200, which is basically the implant med unit that's been branded for Nobel Biocare. On the right is a unit that's been branded for AstraTech. It does come with a built-in irrigation unit, which is kind of neat. These can be hooked up using a standard IV bag with 0.9% sodium chloride, which will basically provide irrigation onto the surgical site. This doesn't necessarily have to be used. One can also simply just get a monoject and a bottle of 0.9% sodium chloride and fill this up and give it to one's assistant to copiously irrigate the area. Do at our office is we actually purchase 10 cc syringes and put a 18 gauge needle on them with a you can take the sharp end of this off, and this is also an excellent source of irrigation to be used for plant dentistry. Before we go any further ahead, I want to touch on one very, very important point. I'm going to try to be as broad in terms of providing a perspective on armaments that can be used in the provision of implant treatment, but by no means is this going to be a complete list of the things that are available out there. In my own personal career, I've been practicing at this point in time for about 14 years. What I've really learned to respect is that there are many different ways to perform different procedures. And ultimately, people will ask me, well, what's the best way? Well, my answer usually to them is, unfortunately, many of the biases that I have in terms of the treatment regimens or the products or materials that I use sort of comes down to sort of my own experience and what I've been either taught or what I found has worked well for me. So my answer to people always is there are many different ways to do things. Consistently, what you want to do if you're a basketball player, you want to be able to consistently hit your three-pointer. It doesn't matter how you do it. Some people can shoot like Reggie Miller. Some people shoot like Dr. Waji Khan. I'll tell you this, Reggie Miller looks a lot prettier when he's hitting a three-pointer. Form is perhaps a bit ugly, but nonetheless, I'm able to achieve a fairly nice three-point result. So my advice here is to consistently use the materials and methods that work best for you. And if someone ever asks you what the best method is, or someone tells you that this is a better or more superior method to something else, my humble advice to you is use the materials and methods that work best in your hands and allow you to achieve consistently superior results. So moving along, there are other implant motors that are available out there. This one over here is kind of neat. It's kind of cool. It's got what we referred to earlier with PRF as the LCF, the looks cool factor. This one's made by Bienaire. It's a little bit more expensive than the implant med unit. However, it works similar in terms of providing slow speed and high speed functions on it, along with internal irrigation and also torque control and an ability to, without having to touch anything, using a foot pedal, reverse the handpiece. This unit can also have an iPad attached to it, and what it'll do is actually record all of the settings that you use to place a particular implant. And what's neat about this is you can actually have this synced with your desktop, and this information can then be printed and put it into the chart. Now, I'm not quite sure what the clinical relevance of this is, and perhaps somebody can explain it to me, but from my perspective, other than being something which looks cool and something which provides a little bit more data, you know, perhaps from a research perspective, this data is going to be useful for us. I'm not really quite sure what the clinical impact for a patient would be. In terms of handpieces, once again, the workhorse in our practice is the WNH 20-to-1 reduction handpiece, which we use with all of our implant med units. Now, you can also get other companies that make a 20-to-1 reduction handpiece. This one, particular one, is made by NSK. And one of the things that many people forget is just the basics of implant dentistry. So the basics is that high speed create excessive amount of heat, but also don't be spinning so slow that we're not cutting anything. And that slow speed is around 50 revolutions per minute, and these are using 20-to-1 reduction handpieces. So not everyone's going to sit there and want to invest money into purchasing an implant handpiece, especially if you're only going to be placing like a handful of implants every year. One of the neat things that you can do if you have this item in your office, this is the Aseptico, it's branded Dentsply in this picture, but the digital torque control endodontic motor, which has a lot of the functions that you actually need in order to use this as an implant motor. Now, when we use this, we have this unit with a 16-to-1 reduction handpiece. So what one can do is using the endodontic motor with a 16-to-1 reduction handpiece is increase the or decrease the RPM to about 1700 RPM and use that as the high speed function. And normally I reduce this down to about 30 RPM to use it as a slow speed function. Try it out yourself and see how you like it. Use sharp drills and lots of irrigation. Those are the two keys. So in terms of implant surgical kits, a variety of companies make their own surgical kits. Normally one can purchase these for around between $1,000 to $2,000, and these come with pretty much everything that you need. In this photograph, you can see an implant surgical kit for Nobel Active guided surgery. In this picture, this is one of the best surgical kits ever made. I had this one when I was placing Astrotech implants. It has so much redundancy built into it, it's not even funny. Unfortunately, the cost of this kit was around $5,000 at the time. This is a photograph of an MIS-7 surgical kit. It has pretty much everything that you need, along with a few prosthetic extras. This is a picture of an implant direct surgical kit. It too actually is fairly comprehensive and includes a lot of the things that you need for the routine placement of dental implants in practice. Special burrs and instruments. So one of the things that you have to realize, which is usually not included in many of these surgical kits, is a thing called a Lindemann burr. Basically, most implant burrs will cut basically down, or I say up and down, but you're only cutting down. If it's the case that you need to move an osteotomy laterally, sometimes people say, well, just put pressure on the side. Well, no, that's not really going to work very well. The only realistic way to move an osteotomy laterally, if your initial burr is found to not be in the right position after putting that guide pin in and taking a radiograph and realizing your angulation was off, is to use a Lindemann burr. So if your surgical kit, which most of them out there these days, do not come with this burr, you can go to any of the aftermarket providers. The two big ones I could tell you about, I'll cover these a little bit later, would be Salvin Dental in the States and The Surgical Room in Canada. They can provide you with these burrs. Now, I basically keep this burr inside every implant surgical kit that I have. an implant distance gauge. So I heard one person, I think it was Howard Farron, once say that if you can't really space out implants by a certain distance, you shouldn't really be practicing dentistry. I sort of chuckled at that comment, and I think Dr. Farron has some valid remarks. If it's the case that you the deficiencies of the hands and deficiencies of the mind is a Gordon Christensen's quote, if you can't get beyond these, perhaps this is not something really for you. However, when one is placing a fair number of implants, it isn't going to hurt you by having something like an implant distance gauge to sort of ensure that the central osteotomy that you're cutting, for considering the size of implant or the width of implant that you're placing at the end, is going to be adequate, so you don't find that you end up with 2 millimeters of bone in approximately, and challenges that exist with having placed implants too close to one another. So these are merely to space out implants, and you want to have at least 3 millimeters between the implants. A torque wrench. So most of the surgical kits come with a torque wrench. It's important to ensure that the torque wrench is going to be able to place the implants into the bone at the torque at which is recommended. Now, I know some people out there are going to sit there and say, well, what if you put it in with too much torque? What happens? Well, the problem is you can end up stripping the internal hex aspect of the implant, or what you can end up doing even in a worst case scenario is end up breaking the body of the implant. Two very not nice things to happen. Now, this is another torque wrench that is available on the market. It can be used for either the placement of a dental implant and also the final placement of a screw at the appropriate torque amount for the recommended torque for that particular prosthetic for that implant system. Retractors. Retractors are always a good thing to have. Some people think that retractors are only for photographs. However, these plain, simple orthodontic band orthodontic bonding retractors that people use in practice to bond orthodontic brackets, they're also useful for moving a lot of the soft tissues out of the way for implant dentistry. This here is a photograph of one of my favorite plant retractors that's available on the market. I'm going to show you a couple pictures here. One is a picture of it in use for a mandible, and as you can see, it retracts a fair amount of the soft tissues for the placement of dental implants in the mandible. It can also be used in the maxilla for taking pictures of your implants while you're placing them, or for also having your assistant retract the tissues so that you can get all that stuff out of the way and have a better surgical access or surgical view of your surgical sites. This is another retractor which is available on the market. It's called a Bishop retractor. If one's never used these while extracting wisdom teeth, it makes wisdom teeth come that much closer to you. And the main reason is this little S-shaped groove where your fingers sort of hold the buccal mucosa when one is using this retractor. Sort of workhorse of all retractors that we have in practice is the Minnesota retractor, which we commonly use in most oral surgical procedures. Another retractor which is useful to have in your armamentaria is one called the Weider retractor. Now, what's cool about this is it's easy to place between the tongue and basically into the lingual vestibule. And it's nice to basically keep that tongue protected from our handpieces and all of the other items that we're going to be using. One can also ask one's assistant to take a slow volume suction or a suction in this area. However, if it's the case that you're using a novice assistant who isn't perhaps the most astute with respect to keeping an eye on these vital tissues, it might be beneficial to have one of these in place. A good needle driver is also very much appreciated. My favorite is the 5 or 6 inch needle driver. Another type of needle driver that comes in very handy, especially when one is manipulating finer sutures or finer needles, is the Castroviejo needle driver. A Bowley gauge is also useful to have available. Now, I don't routinely keep this in my dental implant surgical kit. However, it is useful to have available. And when I say available, I mean, sterilized in a bag, available to be put into the surgical field if one needs to. And this can be used very nicely for the assessment of the thickness of the bone that remains in the residual ridge. Biopsy tissue punches are also excellent. These are great for use for flapless techniques in terms of ensuring that any remaining has been removed. We generally purchase these in the 4 millimeter variety. The nice thing also about them is they're sterile, they're single use, and they're disposable. Here's a picture of what this looks like clinically. Bone expansion screws are also a nice thing to use. Now, these aren't necessarily something for the beginner or novice implant surgeon. However, what's nice about these is after drilling your pilot drill and using your guide pin to ensure you're going in the right direction, one can use these bone expansion screws, and sometimes people will employ these with a bit of a vertical incision as well in order to allow sort of a microfracture of the cortical bone as well. But basically what it ends up doing, it allows you to place implants into very, very thin areas of bone. And I believe we have some photographs here. Oh, sorry, we're going to talk first about ridge splitting of using these. So they're for the narrow ridge. And after the initial twist fill and verification of the direction, one can torque these in to expand the width. So piezo ultrasonic surgery. These are also really neat for making very thin cuts. The only problem with these is that they are very, very slow. If one has never worked with the piezo unit before, one will become very frustrated waiting for these things to work. Now, I've seen a whole bunch of these on the market. One that I've actually been very impressed with is the unit made by a company called Osada, who's based out of Japan. Now, I'm not sponsored by any companies to talk about their products or anything along those lines, but if you're ever at a dental convention or at an implant conference, please do check out that company. And then there's a couple of other interesting companies as well. The other thing about piezo units is that they're very expensive to purchase. The Meisinger company makes some very excellent surgical kits that can be used for things like ridge splitting. They also have one called Transfer Control that I really like. This is the coolest lock and key set that you can use for onlay bone grafting. So I'm going to demonstrate in a picture here. So more or less, you use the one drill to basically create a perforation in the cortical bone and get that bone to start bleeding, and the other drill to basically cut out your donor or your cortical bone graft. And as you can see in this picture here, this fits like a lock and key. Then all one needs to do is get one of these bone fixation screw kits. I generally use a 702 burr to cut through the cortical bone of the donated bone, and I use the 1.5 millimeter, actually it's not 1.5 millimeter, I believe it's like 1.25 millimeter drill from the Salvin bone fixation screw kit. And basically what this does is it creates sort of a lag screw technique for engaging that cortical bone, or sorry, that donated piece of onlay bone graft. However, I wouldn't necessarily advocate this to the beginner or novice implant surgeon. MX grafters are also cool. We didn't use it in this particular case. In this case, we just used a standard particular bone graft. However, these can be used to basically scrape bone, and what's nice about them, it gets some autogenous bone from the patient. There are some clinicians out there who basically believe that by scraping the cortical bone, you're not really getting any of the cool things that exist inside the marrow or the cells that are needed for this bone to heal. So they kind of question the value of using something like the MX grafter in terms of calling it autogenous. They basically say that the value of this would be the same as using a allograft from another patient or a xenograft from another species. Bone grafting syringes are also really neat to use. One needs to ensure that the size of bone graft syringe that they utilize is going to be adequate to pick up the particle size of bone graft that they are going to be grafting in for the patient. In terms of osteotomes, there's two types of osteotomes. There's convex and concave tip osteotomes. So the convex ones are utilized more for the ridge splitting techniques, and similar in terms of how they're employed for the bone expansion screws. The concave tip ones are a little bit more geared towards doing things like a sinus bump procedure, where one doesn't necessarily want to perforate through the sinus floor and perforate the Schneiderian membrane. So in this picture, you can see the concave osteotomes. Also ensuring that when one's using this osteotome in the mallet, which is the next picture, is that you ensure that the initial osteotomy that you've done allows for passive fit of these items into that osteotomy site. A sinus lift kit. Here's a photograph of a sinus lift kit. So basically you want to make sure that it's comprehensive enough that it has some sort of an instrument to punch through your sinus membrane. Also all of the appropriate elevators that can be used for separating the Schneiderian membrane from the bone. A Karensen rongeur is also a useful tool to have if one has not created a large enough sinus window and one needs to expand the size of that sinus window. So we're talking about suppliers. You're wondering, okay, where do I buy all this stuff from? So there's a couple of excellent companies out there that will provide these for you and also provide you with some excellent guidance with respect to what you need. In Canada, there's the Surgical Room and a gentleman by the name of Dan Sampson, who's an excellent resource for you. There's also Salvin Dental, which is in the United States. Their company slogan is everything you need for your implant surgical practice except for the implants. And there's also Ace Surgical, which I found over the years is very useful for providing my office with surgical supplies. In terms of adjuvant irrigation, what can you use? I once heard a clinician once say that chlorhexidine gluconate, so 0.12%, is the most abused drug in the world. Nonetheless, it is excellent for ensuring that there is some sort of a cationic coating on our surgical sites to ensure that all those bacteria that we talked about in that dirty mouth of patients is not going to cause issues for these beautiful implants that we placed. Tetracycline and doxycycline are also utilized by some clinicians, as is citric acid. And some have even advocated the use of 0.125% sodium hypochlorite. However, I'm not aware of using this for surgery. There's also the influence of 0.12% chlorhexidine digluconate rinses on the incidence of infectious complications and implant success. So we routinely will have patients rinse with 0.12% chlorhexidine about 15 milliliters for 30 seconds, just to help once again further reduce the bacterial load inside the mouth prior to performing oral surgical procedures. In terms of a skin disinfectant, many times when we're working on patients, we're not necessarily inside their mouth, but we're sort of, we're fulcruming on their lips, where sometimes the suture will go and it'll scrape by their chin. So one of the things that's important to do is to use some sort of a skin disinfectant. We use this chlorhexidine 2% solution, which is made by a company in Quebec. It's called Dexidin solution. There are other solutions available on the market as well. So in terms of surgical instrumentation, what are you going to do? So pretty much every company, after you've made your incision and you've exposed the surgical site you're going to work in, there's some form of initial burr. We're going to show a video in this presentation in terms of how to sort of go through the entire burr sequence. However, some companies would advocate the use of a round burr. Some companies have these little spade burrs, or call them locator drills. Or in the next picture, you'll see a picture of what they call a pilot drill. So this is your initial drill that you use to cut your osteotomy. And after you do this, you can use something like a direction indicating pin. So this picture here shows it clinically in place, showing three parallel implants. And there's also a radiograph showing this pin in place. Then there's just a sequence of other drills that you can use. And it's sort of beyond the scope of this presentation to get into the drilling sequence for every single implant company that's out there. The important thing to know is you need to be able to know what the drilling sequence is for the particular implant system that you are using. And this includes not just the pilot drill, the direction indicating pins, and the whole series, but if you need to use a cortical bone drill to make that cortical bone larger than the size of the implant, so as to avoid things like compression necrosis. Should you be using something like a bone tap in order to tap the implant prior to placement of the implant? So know the system that you have, and know the system that you have very well. So that was just an example of sort of the going through the drill sequence to place a dental implant, rather rudimentary example. Drilling through plastic is never quite the same as drilling into teeth, as you can see from the placement aspect. When you actually get to the point where you need to place the implant, when you're going into very, very dense cortical bone, the implant will not actually go all the way through. And in this sort of a case, what you really need to do is use something which, like what you see here, a screw tap to tap the bone, or what some other clinicians suggest, which is over prepare the cortical aspect of the bone in order to facilitate implant placement. You can sort of use higher values of torque to get the implant in. However, the problem with this is you run the risk of causing compression necrosis of the bone in the coronal aspect, so the cortical bone. And classically, many times in implant placement, people talk about there's always like 1 millimeter or 2 millimeters of crestal bone loss that you just have to accept. Well, one of the reasons this may be occurring is a matter of the manner in which these implants are being placed. So if it's the case that we're placing them with too much torque or putting too much stress on that crestal bone, that cortical bone, using things like a screw tap or even over preparation of that bone may be beneficial. So moving to the next picture, you can see a picture of just some various implant drivers that are available on the market. Implant drivers come for various and various shapes and sizes. Every implant system sort of has its own implant driver. The best thing to do is to use the implant driver that goes along with your implant system. The next picture is basically of a bunch of hand torque wrenches that can also be used to place implants. Now, these two are not actually torque wrenches. They're just wrenches that have adapters to put the implant drivers on. So you can either use the handpiece, as you saw me use in the video, or you can use one of these hand torque wrenches. They also have little screwdriver looking things, which I believe I have in the next picture here, which is another type of hand tool that you can use to place implants. These are very useful in the anterior maxilla when one's trying to engage the palatal bone. So as you saw in the video, after you put the implant in and you clean everything up and irrigate everything, you need to put some sort of a cover screw on. Most implant systems have corresponding cover screws. Some implant systems, as I've mentioned in the video, come with a brand new cover screw, which you can use for every single patient. Other implant systems, you have to buy the cover screw separately, which leads to some clinicians sterilizing these screws. You can take a close look at the screw on the left. This is actually a screw which I had taken from a patient and we'd meticulously cleaned out. And you can just tell from the other two, it's very difficult to get these things clean. And if you have a patient and you have an open flap and you just place some beautiful implants and bone graft and stuff, the last thing you'd want is for the drudge on a reused cover screw to be sort of the nidus for causing a post-operative infection. So my recommendation always is include a new cover screw in every implant placement. And if it's the case that you're using an implant from a company that sells the cover screw in addition to the implant, basically you'll have to factor the cost of that cover screw into the cost of implant treatment. The next photograph here is we're covering a variety of healing abutments. So sometimes people will not immediately load an implant with something like a temporary tooth, but put a healing abutment on. So you're gonna have some sort of loading, or not necessarily axial loading, but horizontal forces that can act upon the implant. These aren't necessarily a bad thing if they're at a reasonable level. However, once again, going into, we're going to talk about this when we talk about basics of immediate implant dentistry, but one of the risks that you do have when you're putting anything but a cover screw on an implant is that there can be some sort of forces acting upon it. These healing abutments come in a variety of shapes and sizes. One of the things that we covered was Wolf's Law in Lecture 3 about bone metabolism and wound healing. And so one of the things that you can do from a physiological workout perspective, as opposed to going from cover screw to boom, here's a molar on the implant, you can actually train the bone for the patient. So if you have a patient who you think would benefit, you're not quite sure what sort of bite forces this patient's going to be placing on this implant, you can actually train their bone by actually going through a gradually larger set of healing abutments. And one of the things that we've actually done in our practice is not only just giving patients a higher healing abutment, but they actually make wider healing abutments as well. So moving along to the next slide, which is a photograph of just some various healing abutments that are available from a variety of manufacturers. Believe it or not, so both the healing abutment on the left and the healing abutment on the right are for the same size platform implant. You'll notice, as I talked about training the bone, you'll notice that one, the implants on the left are a little bit wider and more robust. So obviously you're going to be putting a larger healing abutment on, that's going to be placing more force on that implant. And it's not quite the size. What I should have done in this photograph is taken a picture of an actual tooth and shown you these healing abutments and the larger ones in relation to the size of an actual tooth. But if you trust me, you can take my word for it. Here's a photograph of just a variety of screwdrivers. You saw me bustling around in that video trying to make a screwdriver out of the surgical kits. A lot of the surgical kits don't actually have a screwdriver in them. Some of the companies basically have those inside, the one-piece screwdriver, that is, inside the prosthetic kits. So one of the things that's nice to have is to have one of these screwdrivers if you're like me and you like having something as one piece. If it's two pieces, there's a risk that your staff can throw it out or it can fall apart while you're working with it and fall in a patient's mouth. I like having a one-piece screwdriver. Call me old school or old-fashioned. Yes, I can start saying I'm old now. Or if you saw, as you saw me doing the video, the majority of the surgical kits, they do have sort of a hand wrench that can go on to the screwdriver pieces that are made to go into the handpiece. Going to the next slide here, basically go back into our checklist. So checklist is something we introduced in many lectures ago, and we're going to continually hammer these checklists away till they basically become ingrained in your mind, and this is something that you can do as a second nature thing. So surgical quality checklist. So making sure that the bone quality was assessed and asking yourself also saying, okay, let's see here. Mrs. Jones wants a 5-unit prosthetic. So in a normal world, if we were doing a 5-unit bridge, we'd consider something like Antti's law and say, okay, how many teeth and what is the quality of the bone around these teeth that we'd want in order to provide this lady with at least 15 to 20 years. So the question that you need to ask yourself is, has an adequate number of dental implants been placed for the planned prosthesis? And there's nothing ever wrong in over-engineering. Number three, asking yourself if the initial mechanical stability of the dental implants has been assessed. And so there's two things you need to assess when you're placing an implant. Number one is torque. And torque, remember, is sort of like that rotational force, right? The second thing is lateral stability. Many times if you're doing an immediate implant, so suppose you're putting an implant into where a central incisor was, a lot of times the size of the implant is going to be a lot smaller than the size of where the root form of that central incisor was. And so when you actually do your osteotomies and place your implant, you'll say, wow, I put it in at 30 Newton centimeters torque, which is ideal. There's excellent primary stability. But what I'm going to ask you to do is take some sort of an instrument, so like one of those direction indicating pins, or even like some of the transfer copings that they have, and place it on the implant and put some lateral force on it and try to assess what type of lateral stability the implant has. So there's two things you want to talk about when you're talking about mechanical stability. Number one is torque, and number two is assessing what that lateral stability is like. And objective and subjective measures actually will guide the amount of healing time that you're going to want prior to restoring these implants. Number four, have the necessary intraoperative radiographs been taken? Number five, has this cover screw or healing abutment for the patient been placed? So let's talk about a case now. We like talking about cases so that we can bring some real world examples in. 30-year-old healthy male who works in the trades. He has not been to a dentist in a long time, but he's willing to complete comprehensive restorative and periodontal treatment, and he's seeking to have missing teeth replaced with implants. So we'll take a look at the Panorex or the panoral radiograph for this patient, and you can see that there's a number of teeth that are decayed and broken off at the gum line, and he requires some obvious caries, some really long roots. The bone levels, just from a gross perspective, look fairly good here. So more or less for this patient here, what's going to need to be done from a treatment plan perspective is taking care of their basic restorative, periodontal, and oral surgical treatment. This also includes a caries risk analysis for the patient from a preventative perspective so that they don't end up in this boat again. And then basic extraction of the upper right first premolar as it's causing him pain. In an ideal world, we could always try to treat this as an immediate placement for the patient. However, when the area is infected, we know that the bone or the pH of the bone is going to be acidic, and this isn't necessarily going to be good from the healing of the bone for the implant perspective. You can put the patient on a course of antibiotics and try to basically balance things out that way. But in this case, we thought it'd be best to allow extract the upper right first premolar first, is causing him pain, allow things to heal up, and then basically follow up after the sanative phases of treatment have been completed and see if implant treatment is going to be something which is appropriate for him. So we received a consent from the patient, took preoperative photos, models, radiographs, all of our pre-surgical records, and more or less you can see from this picture here, this is what the patient presented like after healing. There wasn't a significant amount of buccal lingual bone loss. The patient has some fairly robust periodontium. The oral hygiene has significantly improved. Basic caries and periodontal treatment has been completed, and on follow-up, we've been satisfied. We take a look at this patient from this shot here. You can see that there's adequate inter-arch clearance for this patient. From an occlusal scheme perspective, this patient appears to have a fair amount of wear on his teeth for someone who's only 30 years old. From the radiograph, you can see that there's adequate root form, and so the risk of hitting the other teeth is going to be fairly low, and there's excellent bone quality here as well. So we basically proceed with our implant treatment plan. In this case here, we decided to go with a full thickness flap. So you can see how thick that palatal tissue is on this patient. We've exposed the bone and used the Woodson elevator to sort of guide us with respect to where that buccal bone is. And after determining that the buccal bone was of adequate thickness to proceed with the placement of an implant, we go ahead and do our initial osteotomy. So this is using that spade drill, or that locator drill, as I discussed, and then proceeding with using the pilot drill to drill our initial osteotomy. We take the pin, as you can see in this picture here, place the guide pin into the osteotomy site, and we will now take a radiograph of that to confirm that from a mesial distal aspect, we're going in the proper direction, and we're not sort of like going to be running the risk of hitting that cuspid root or hitting the root of the adjacent premolar. And in this photograph over here, you can see the final implant, which has been placed. And after the placement of the implant, we take a radiograph, put a cover screw on, suture him up, take a radiograph to make sure nothing else needs to be changed. As you can see, this is an excellent placement. The next picture is going to basically demonstrate the patient with some sutures in. We give the patient post-operative instructions, a prescription for an antibiotic for about 7 days, and some mild analgesics as well. Post-operative checklist here. Once again, checklist. You can never have enough things in your checklist, is to basically ensure that if there was a transitional prosthesis, so some sort of like a flipper, a partial denture, Essex retainer, something along those lines, that the transitional prosthesis had been placed and the patient has been given appropriate instructions with respect to management of that prosthesis. Number two, that post-operative instructions have been provided, so highly care of the surgical site, type of oral hygiene is adequate, types of rinses that they can use. The post-operative medications have been provided for the patient in the form of both analgesics and antibiotics. If it's the case that you're working on a sinus, we'll also give the patient the sinus precaution, which usually is the prescription of some sort of decongestant. And usually I give them a decongestant for about 2 or 3 days just to ensure that ostium of the maxillary sinus remains patent, so as to prevent any likelihood of developing a maxillary sinusitis. Number four is post-operative follow-up appointment has been scheduled. So more often than not, I like to see my patients after about 7 days just to see how things are going, make sure things are healing well. You'd rather somebody come back sooner rather than later, or they come back sooner where you can actually do something as opposed to late when you cannot. And number five, ensuring that the patient is fit for discharge with a responsible adult escort. And usually they need the escort if it's the case that they've had a large amount of work done, or if it's the case they've provided any form of sedation. So flap versus flapless surgery. There have been some suggestions that flap access can decrease blood flow to the bone, and this can lead to bone loss. And basically the pathophysiology of this is that when there's a tooth in the area, that the buccal bone, which is very thin, that it has blood flow from not only the buccal mucosa or that periosteum that you're going to be taking away when you make a flap, but also from the periodontal ligament of the tooth. And when a tooth is actually removed and you raise a flap, that basically you've no
vascular support for that buccal bone, and that is why the buccal bone degenerates. So when teeth are present, as I stated here, the buccal bone has collateral or blood flow from the periodontal ligament. And however, the problem is that if we take this sort of buy into this sort of ideology, one would never sort of go and raise a flap. A flap sometimes, unfortunately, is required in certain cases. So, and because you can also appreciate the bone using a technique like bone sounding. We'll demonstrate this in a video later on. So you can sort of do things that can sort of mitigate the need for the placement of a flap. However, sometimes you can't get away without a flap. It also should be noticed that a flapless procedure is a lot cleaner. So in this photograph here, you can see in this case here, where a buccal bone graft was placed and a fixation screw was used, you need to sort of have a flap access in order to assess not only the success of the surgery or of the bone graft, but you also need to be able to remove that screw. Now, you can also remove the screw just making a small incision on the side and, you know, tweaking it out sort of thing, but sometimes you need to make a flap. And this, in this picture here, we'll show you what flapless looks like. Sometimes you can get away with just using your needle or your periodontal probe to appreciate where the bone is. One of my colleagues, he tells me he uses his fingers. It's the most expensive CT scanner in the world. He puts his fingers down. Between his two fingers, he feels something. And what he feels is bone. That's his scanner. And in this photograph here, you can see the picture of this patient with the flapless surgery. And you can see it's a fairly successful surgery. So flap tips. So more or less, it's your standard modified Widman flap that they teach in dental school and in oral surgery class to dental students. So you want to make sure that the base is wider than the apex. You also want to try to preserve keratinized tissue, as we know that keratinized tissue does a lot better long-term in terms of preventing things like peri-implant mucositis and peri-implantitis. You try to preserve the papilla. So if you want to pause this video and go back to that slide where I showed you that buccal bone graft, you'll notice that the incisions weren't made in right through the papilla. We actually tried to preserve the papilla to a certain extent. So what type of dental implant system should you use? Basically, in lecture one, we had an overview of dental implants and talked about the types and features that have come along. And we stated that strategy must be supported by the structure. So there isn't one implant system that you can sort of like place in every case. There's always going to be a particular case in which a particular implant is going to be better. What I suggest is that when you first start off with a system that, you know, has the ability to be used in many different applications. Something like the Zimmer tapered screw vent implant, which has been around for a long, long time. It's fairly straightforward, it's fairly easy to use. Something like the Nobel Active implant is a very technique sensitive and situational specific implant. So it may not be the best to try to use as a first line. However, if you can master the placement of this, I'm not gonna hate on the Nobel Active. I think it's a great implant. I have them in my practice as well. But just remember the point that strategy must be supported by structure. Also, the choice of implant system has to be based on the understanding of the biomechanical, physiologic, and microbiological factors that are sort of gonna affect the process of osseointegration. So I mentioned before about the people coming to your office and telling you about new things, new technologies. You need to have a critical evaluation of new technologies, new products, and techniques to ensure that these are going to be basically supported by sound and valid scientific data and long-term studies. Sometimes people come to me and ask me, what do you think about zirconia implants? And I say, hey, you know the 30-year studies on Brandemark's implants placed in the 1970s, they look pretty good. Some of these newer things, I'm not saying that they're necessarily good. I'm not saying they're necessarily bad. It's just that from my perspective, if a patient was to ask me, what would you want in your mouth? I would probably tend towards going with the devil I know as opposed to the devil I do not. So I'm just going to leave it at ensure that there's sound, valid scientific data, ensure that there's appropriately implemented long-term studies. One final note, Health Canada and the FDA approvals need to be in place for the items being used. So you can't just go get something that was made in Chinatown and some guy tells you that, you know, you can get these implants for like $30. But note that all medical devices that are licensed for sale in Canada are listed at this website, www.mdall.ca. And when in doubt, just ask your colleague for some help. So we're going to talk about a few other things here before we before we conclude this lecture, we're going to talk about bone grafting. So in terms of bone grafting, there's different types of materials, and each one sort of has its types and features. So we talk about autografts, so autogenous graft, that's from the patient. We talk about allografts. These are usually cadaveric sources or from a human donor. And these are usually all been irradiated, and some are mineralized, some are demineralized. There's a variety of sort of different things. Then there's xenografts, which come from an animal source. And then finally, alloplastic and synthetic bone graft material, things like BioOss and Perioglass. And then we're going to talk about Comito Bio, which is a company which has introduced basically a very rather unique twist on grafting materials. So in terms of grafting materials, we talk about three principles about grafting materials. We talk about a graft being osteogenic. The only thing that's going to really be osteogenic is an autogenous graft from the patient. And this is sort of the mantra behind why people go for an anterior iliac crest or posterior iliac crest or even tibial tuberosity graft for a patient. And then the other two we talk about are things being osteoinductive or osteoconductive. So more or less just acting as a scaffold for the patient, for their own body to sort of come in there and form bone. So we then talk about Comito Bio. Comito Bio is a really interesting concept. They basically said that you have bone, which is mineralized, but you also have dentin and enamel, which are mineralized, and they're all hydroxyapatite. So why not grind up extracted teeth, which have not been endodontically treated? There's no decay. You curette the soft tissue away, so you're basically just keeping the root aspect of the tooth, grind it up, and you create this basically material. And I'm assuming that you can vary the sizes of this to go from like a fine grind to a very coarse grind, and you get something which you can use as a bone graft. Now the studies on this, they're rather new. I just thought it was rather a bit of a neat proposition that was proposed, and I thought I'd include it as part of this presentation. So we talked about bone grafting sources. We talked about autogenous. So there's local sources, so the mandibular symphysis, the third molar region, the angle of the mandible, the tuberosity. These are regions that one can look intraorally for bone graft sources. Remember that the facial bones are intramembranous ossification as compared to endochondral ossification. But as I'd mentioned in that lecture on bone metabolism and wound healing, there really aren't any studies to demonstrate that there's any difference whether you use intramembranous versus endochondral bone. Then there's distant sources as well, things like the rib, the iliac crest, the tibia, and the calvaria, which are kind of neat. In the old days, we used to perhaps rely upon these. However, one of my mentor, oral maxillofacial surgeons, he once said that, you know, we need to start moving away from the morbidities that are associated with going to these sites, try to stay more intraoral or more local, and also try to benefit more from some of the other allogenic and alloplastic materials that are available out there. So in terms of allogenic materials that are out there, you have things like frozen bone graft sources, you have freeze-dried, there's demineralized versus mineralized. I will add a little plug here about demineralized versus mineralized. The entire concept of providing a demineralized bone graft was that you get more RHBMP in the bone graft. And it was basically found in a study that the amount of this growth factor was clinically insignificant. And more or less, by giving the patient a demineralized bone graft, all you're sort of giving them is kind of like a glorified, expensive collagen graft. So we only use mineralized graft. However, like hard toothbrushes, and you know, pretty much any dentist worth his weight in gold would never recommend a hard toothbrush for a patient, unless, of course, you know, they're using it to clean the cracks in the in between their tiles. However, these are still on the market. And the thing about bone grafts is I still see demineralized bone grafts that are on the market. I'm not quite really sure what applications they're being used in, but I wanted to make sure that I did cite that point about the benefits, or the perceived benefit of using a demineralized bone graft, was because it was thought to have a clinically significant amount of RHBMP, which it does not. So in terms of bone grafting, we're also going to talk about different sources here. So here's a picture, basically going into a little bit more detail. This is from Dr. Carl Misch's website at the ICOI, and other biomaterials that are available, things like methyl methacrylate, silicone. There's things like Teflon, poly tetrafluoroethylene, which is the name, the trade name would be Gore-Tex, kind of cool. Calcium phosphates, things like plaster of Paris, tricalcium phosphate, and hydroxyapatite. Now we're going to talk about membranes. So anytime you're going to be putting any sort of a graft material in, you need to use a membrane. So there's a biological rationale for the use of membranes. And basically the purpose of this, it's going to be a barrier to prevent soft tissue ingrowth and to allow bone to grow. And you have to remember that soft tissue or epithelium grows a lot faster than bone. And so this barrier basically is there to sort of help prevent that epithelium. So when epithelium sort of like hits like a sort of a membrane or a stop, it stops growing. The other purpose of a membrane is, remember, for bone growth, you want something that's going to be somewhat rigid and not allow movement of that graft. Otherwise, you're not going to get bone forming there. There's different types of membrane. There's resorbable and non-resorbable membranes. You can also use things like the free gingival graft. So I've seen clinicians actually bone graft a patient and then take a free gingival graft from, say, the tuberosity region and just suture that into place in order to cover that. And the other cool thing is something like platelet-rich fibrin. We covered the applications of platelet-rich fibrin in lecture 3. We'll put another video in here just to demonstrate the harvesting of blood. And this one, I actually show the fabrication of the platelet-rich fibrin membrane. And in this case, we used it in a patient who we were doing a ridge preservation, a sinus bump, and implant placement on. So in terms of tissue engineering, we talk about three things again. Remember, we talk about cells, we talk about a scaffold, and we talk about growth factors. And there's this trilogy that you need to sort of get hammered into your brain, and you need to understand anytime you're talking about tissue engineering, you need to think about these three things and how they're incorporated into your tissue engineering efforts. So there are different solutions for anatomical limitations. We're going to describe two of those solutions right here. One is the onlay bone graft, and the other is the sinus lift. And so the onlay bone graft is a surgical solution that has been suggested for patients who have adequate height but not adequate width of bone. And then the sinus lift, the photograph on the right, is basically for patients who have adequate width but not necessarily adequate height in the posterior maxilla. So we'll start with the first one over here. And the first one we're going to talk about here is this is the onlay bone graft. So this basically is going back to that picture that I talked about earlier, the transfer control drill system that's provided by Meisinger in terms of having sort of like a lock-in key. This sort of just gives you a better picture sort of how the two pieces sort of like work together. I will note here that the use of the prep drill in order to decorticate the bill, it was inadequate in the picture on the left there. That was just for demonstration purposes. And in this picture here, we're going to talk about the sinus bump. And so basically, when there's at least 4 to 6 millimeters of bone in the posterior maxilla, so you can have good fixation of your implant and not going to lose your implant into the sinus, it's a very clean, easy procedure. Describing it on a video sort of goes beyond the scope of this video. The only thing you need to understand is it's a blind procedure. So following the pictures, you make your osteotomy just short of what your perceived residual ridge height is, and you basically proceed to a wider set of drills. And finally, you take your osteotome. Remember, it's the convex tip osteotome, so not the sharp one. The sharp one's what you use to do a ridge split, but the one that has that sort of convex tip to it, so it's not going to blow right through. And more or less what you do is just to take a little osteotome and tap and basically fracture the floor of the sinus wall, and then gently raise that Schneiderian membrane up. I once asked a colleague of mine, what's the Schneiderian membrane like to handle? And the best description for it, it's kind of like wet tissue paper, right? So if you can imagine how gentle you need to be with a wet Kleenex or wet tissue paper, that's sort of how it is. Another good surgical simulator for a sinus lift or a sinus bump is an egg. And if you've never seen this done, go to any trade show, and pretty much every time you're looking at purchasing some sort of sinus lift or sinus surgery equipment, they always have eggs along hand or alongside in order to provide some sort of a clinical demonstration. The sinus lift was first described by Dr. Tatum in 1986, and more or less this is going to be done when there's less than two millimeters of crestal bone, and this is a lateral window approach. You need to ensure that there's an absence of sinus pathology. So more often than not, whenever I'm considering a sinus lift in the patient, I always send them for a cone beam CT scan. It's for two reasons. Number one, to rule out any sort of sinus pathology, but you also have to take into account the position of the middle superior alveolar artery. In about 15% of patients, it's going to be right in that site that you want to do your lateral window in. And if you have it close by, you can sort of, you know, try to avoid it, try to tie it down, try to clamp it, try to use an electrosurge to basically cauterize it. But if it's inside the bone, remember, this is a vessel inside the bone, okay? This is not something which is easy to sort of handle. And anytime you cut an artery, it's not fun if it's your first time. So you have to take the anatomy or the course that this vessel traverses into account when one is sort of planning a sinus lift. So something like a cone beam CT is always good to order just to sort of figure out where this thing is. And this picture over here basically demonstrates from top to bottom the procedure. So basically it's a matter of making an incision, wide base, modified Woodman flap, proper exposure of that piriform recess. And as you can see, in this case here, they've used some sort of a drill to basically thin out that bone, so you sort of get that little halo. And then it's just a matter of using some sort of a punch. And whenever you're using the sinus lift instruments, always make sure you keep them on bone. I've seen people sometimes actually try to push the membrane off. You're going to perforate. How do you know you're perforated? It's going to be the darkest black you've ever seen in your life. So picture number 5 there, you can see that there is a nice sinus window, and in 6 they put the bone graft in. We're going to do a case discussion over here using the sinus lift as an example. So a 50-year-old female patient presents with a failed anterior abutment for a 3-unit fixed bridge on natural teeth. She was a regular patient we've been seeing over years. Her maxillary second premolar is basically failed catastrophically. So she'd come in to see us, and from her perspective, she had some issues with this anterior abutment over a fair amount of time. And as you can see from this photograph here, there appears to be some sort of a radiolucency that's like sort of getting that classic J pattern for some type of an endoperio lesion. And on taking an oblique picture, you can see that there is a fracture basically going through and through. So what are we going to do for this patient? Let's come up with a treatment plan. So from a treatment plan perspective, basically it's we determined that the posterior abutment, the bone, and that the prosthetic that was on there was actually sound. And so we could section it off quite easily and just polish it. It was a full gold crown. We could polish it off fairly easily for the patient and just allow her to keep that, and that would be rather conservative dentistry from our perspective. With that, we would extract the 1.5 for her, and basically we're going to wait for the soft tissue to heal in this case. And the main reason is when we talk about the basics of immediate implant dentistry, we talk about you got to have appropriate soft tissue for closure. So if we're planning a sinus lift for this lady, we need to make sure that we have some soft tissue to close this area up. The last thing we want here is to surgically create an oral antral communication with a lot of expensive implants and bone grafts inside there. So then we're going to plan to do a lateral wall sinus lift with bone grafting and the placement of 2 dental implants with the platelet-rich fibrin membranes in 2 places. Number one, I always put them down or put some sort of a membrane in my sinus lift just to reinforce that sinus, or in case you have some type of a little micro tear, even sometimes you can't even see it, it'll cover it up really nicely. Other options you have are to use a collagen membrane or to use something like Surgicel. And the second platelet-rich fibrin membrane is going to go on top of our window. So in this photograph over here, what we can see is a radiograph. Basically, with our clinical treatment plan software, we determined there's 2.2 millimeters in that second premolar region, and we have about 11 millimeters in our first premolar region. And so clinically, we take a look at this site, and you can see that this area is healed up beautifully. You can see that there's that beautiful crown on the 1.7 that we conveniently left. Couple of stains on the margin of her first premolar. Sorry, I kept saying premolar. It's actually her first molar that we're doing the sinus lift for. So here's a picture, modified Woodman flap with adequate access and adequate exposure. And then what you basically do is we've thinned out the bone to sort of get a viewing of that sort of like that black sort of halo to determine that we're close to the sinus. At this point, what we basically do is we use the sinus lift instruments and we follow the bone. Remember, follow the bone. You can basically push the membrane down. I didn't take a photograph of it here. It'll be better to see in a video, but when the patient's actually breathing in and out, you can see that membrane move. So you can see here, I've taken some platelet-rich fibrin and basically reinforced that membrane. And then the next thing we do is we pack some bone inside here. I was trained by Dr. Richard Kraut down in Montefiore. If any of you had the pleasure to actually work with him, he's a phenomenal oral maxillofacial surgeon and a great guy to learn from. So then when we proceed, why I mentioned him was there's an important thing. He teaches you when you're doing a sinus lift to place your bone graft place your bone graft, place your implants, and then you got to place bone graft again afterwards. So you can see here we made our osteotomies to place our two implants. In this case here, these are MIS C1 conical connection implants. So both implants have been placed, bone grafts in there, and you can see why you need to go back and place bone graft a second time, because when the implants are placed, some of the bone graft gets displaced and you want to pack more inside there. So we pack some more bone inside there. You see that's packed up really nicely. We place a platelet-rich fibrin membrane on top of this. And I actually like tunneling into that palatal tissue and using some sort of a horizontal mattress suture to secure that in place. And once that's been done, we have some sutures in place. And that's more or less it. Postoperatively, here's a postoperative gap. You see that beautiful, so it's like a little ellipse you see where the sinus lift took place. Postoperatively, write up a prescription for the patient. So usually it's post-op antibiotic, some sort of either amoxicillin or clindamycin, the decongestant as well, and some sort of analgesics. So we'll talk now about ridge splitting. So ridge splitting is another means by which of dealing with patients who have adequate height but inadequate width. So more or less what you're going to do here is you're drilling through the cortical bone and either using bone expansion screws or the concave, right? So the pointy osteotomes basically fracture this piece of bone, and you can or use implants to sort of get some stability more apical to where these ridge splits are going to be made. The other thing you can use for this are some of the crest control surgical kits that are available from Meisinger. So in this photographs here, we're not talking about ridge splitting in this course. We're just mentioning it so that people are familiar with it. So in this photograph here, you can see that the surgeon is using one of those bone expansion screws after the initial osteotomies have been placed through the cortical bone. So there's not only an osteotomy vertically, but horizontally as well. These are very, very thin osteotomies. These have been performed more than likely with a piezo piezo saw. You can also use a drill, a very, very thin drill. However, you'll never be able to get as thin a cut with a drill as you can with a piezo saw. However, a piezo saw takes a lot longer, as I'd mentioned, to work. In this photograph, you can see the final implant's been placed and what this looks like. And so the little void, you have two choices. You can either just let fill up with blood and let the sort of bone heal itself, or you can take some either autogenous or allograft or xenograft bone and pack that in this area as well. My own personal preference is I like packing something in there as opposed to, you know, the patient leaving, going out of my office and having a bag of popcorn and something else sliding underneath the flap and getting inside there. Here's a photograph basically showing a surgeon who attempted to do the initial osteotomies using a handpiece. I'm assuming that the burr here was a lot larger than, say, a 701 or a small 330 burr. I'm assuming they used a 702 here. And in this photograph here, you can see another attempt, very thin maxilla. The sutures that have been placed are just intraoperative, just to sort of help get some reflection of that palatal tissue. And more or less, you're going to see in the next photograph here that the very skilled surgeon here has basically used the implants and the bone expansion screws to widen these cortical plates and place implants in this patient without any significant onlay surgery. So we're going to talk a little bit about periodontal plastics techniques to close up this lecture. I realize this lecture has been going on for a bit now. So we're going to talk about different things that our friendly periodontists have sort of brought to the implantology world. So there's a few things that are out there. We talk about changing the soft tissue biotype for the patient in terms of thickening the connective tissue. So there's different ways to do this. The easiest thing is to basically place a connective tissue graft for the patient. And there's many sources you can go to for this. There's autogenous sources like the palate. We'll talk about a few of the techniques that are out there. There's also the tuberosity of the patient, which is an excellent source. However, if you are using the tuberosity, usually the connective tissue back there is kind of thick. So you have to sort of use a scalpel and a little bit of clever knife skills in order to thin it out, in order to make it useful for the tissue that you're going to be using it. There's also the acellular dermal matrices that are available out there, products like Alloderm. The key thing to remember when you're using something like an acellular dermal matrix is that these need to be covered by the patient's own soft tissue. If they're not, it's usually not a good outcome. And then there's also different types of accesses that are available. The VISTA, the vestibular incision, subperiosteal tunnel access is a cool little technique. I'll show you a picture of it. You'll have to probably either take a course or check out an online video. This has been around, it's been reported in the periodontal literature for at least 10 or 15 years. However, it's a really neat technique and neat procedure to do in order to provide patients with grafts. So the first picture here is basically showing the trap door. So this is in the palate. So this is kind of the basic way to harvest a CT graft from a patient. So more or less you make a three-walled sort of incision, you raise a full thickness flap on the patient, you cut away the piece that you need of the connective tissue, and you suture back the rest. The problem with this technique is there's a higher likelihood of wound dehiscence and of a flap necrosis as compared to what the periodontist technique that they use. Most of the skilled periodontists will use what they refer to as the pita pocket technique. So it's a single incision, and more or less they have a bit of a fan-shaped motion in order to harvest this graft. One that wants to take an excellent course to learn how to take this do this procedure, Dr. John Russo, I've talked about him previously. He's a periodontist out in Jacksonville, Florida. He's affiliated with the Medical University of South Carolina. It runs an excellent course twice a year, 3 days. One's down in South Carolina, one's down in Vegas. Great guy, great course. So if you want to learn these techniques and master them, that's where I'd suggest you go. Did I mention it's a cadaver-based course? So you actually get to practice this on real humans, real cadavers, that is. Another neat thing that you can do to augment the soft tissue biotype in the anterior is what they call the vascularized interpositional graft, once again, beyond the scope of what you can teach in an online course. However, I just thought I'd include a picture of it just in case anyone wants to know, or put a picture to all these procedures. And this is just a photograph of just a subperiosteal tunnel. Sorry, I'd mentioned the VISTA, the vestibular incision subperiosteal tunnel access. However, I don't have a photograph of that here. This is just a subperiosteal tunnel, just to show you some of the cool things that you can do with patients. And now I believe we have one final video.
Pinch. And if you can just have the gauze ready. Straight up, please. broke it, didn't I? It's right here, grab it. Yeah, no, this is definitely not as per plan. Okay, good. Do you have the scissors? Can you get me the scissors, please? Perfect. Take a piece of gauze here too and just suck up any extra moisture. There, good, sweet.
So we're going to talk a bit about guided surgery. So guided surgery requires a cone beam CT. It also requires sleeves, and it can be done flapless. So this is one of the advantages of guided surgery, that you can do it flapless. As I'd mentioned, flapless surgery can be cleaner. It also doesn't sort of eliminates the likelihood of getting any bone loss associated with flap placement. However, irrigation using these guides can be a bit challenged because you're basically covering up your surgical site with these thick pieces of plastic and these sleeves. So sometimes getting meaningful irrigation in these areas is a bit of a challenge. And there's also the cost that's associated with guided surgery. So we'll take a look at a couple of photographs here, and more or less in these photographs you can see surgical guides and the pins to sort of secure those guides in cases of patients who are totally edentulous. Here's an example of what some of the sleeves look like. There also are guides where there aren't sleeves. The problem with using the guides without sleeves is you might as well just not use guided surgery, as they don't work very well. So you need to use sleeves in order to take advantage of the purpose of the guides. Here's another photograph basically showing some guides in place and some of the results that you can achieve with guides. Last thing we're going to talk about here is patient monitoring. So pulse oximetry, non-invasive blood pressure, fluid management, electrocardiogram for certain cases, and we're going to talk about management of dental emergencies later in this series. So as to not take the wind out of that presentation, we're just going to have a picture here just showing a simple pulse oximetry unit you can buy. We recently in our office just upgraded from Criticare units to the EDAN units. I mean, they're all basically the same. If one wants, you can get a very sophisticated patient monitoring unit. However, that's not always necessary. So the key points, if you've actually survived this entire lecture and not totally fallen asleep, is if you, from a surgical phase perspective, remember the most important things is implant positioning. So this is both buccolingual, axial, and searing. You have adequate separation from not only each implant, but also from the teeth. That the drill speeds, high speed is 1500 RPM, and slow speeds 30 to 50 RPM. Those sounds that you heard blowing out my voice in that video sample, those are the sounds you're looking for. The torque is generally at around 30 Newton centimeters. You don't want to over torque, and you definitely don't want to under torque, because that implies that you don't have good primary stability. Remember that primary stability is two things, not just torque, but also lateral stability. And in terms of irrigation, copious, copious, copious amounts of irrigation. I once had an assistant say, am I irrigating too much? I said, there's no such thing as too much irrigation. So the next lecture is lecture 7, which is basically the post-surgical follow-up lecture. I've once again included a copy of all of the references that we used in the production of this lecture series. As I've mentioned in pretty much every lecture, I would highly encourage you to look up these references, as they're, number one, they're excellent references in terms of getting to where we got, but they also expand upon a lot of the information that I've provided, and they will definitely augment your implant education. So on behalf of the entire dental treatment team at the Cataraqui Woods Dental Implant Institute, I want to thank you for participating in our lecture.